Hello, everyone. Thank you all so much for coming to the first session of David Millstone's Square Dance History Series. My name is Joanna Reiner Wilkinson, and I'm the Director of Programs for CDSS, the Country Dance and Song Society. Our presentation tonight is called A Square Dance Family Tree, which is all about the history and evolution of today's squares. I want to introduce our presenter, David Millstone, who's from Lebanon, New Hampshire. He's been a dance caller for more than 40 years. He calls squares, contras, English country dance, and family-friendly events. David is a past president of CDSS, and he has a long interest in the history of many branches of country dance. He is a co-author of Cracking Chestnuts, which is a book about classic American contra dances, and he wrote the Contra Dance History chapter of Dance a While. He has produced video documentaries about Bob McQuillan, Dudley Laufman, and Ralph Sweet, and he created the Square Dance History Project and helped organize the 2011 Dare to Be Square event at the John C. Campbell Folk School and created the website for the Square Dance Hall of Fame. And his current project, which is under construction, celebrates bands who played for contra and square dances in the early years of their dance communities. So, David, with that, I will hand things over to you.
Great. Well, it's wonderful to be here. I've been a dancer since the early 70s when I moved up to New Hampshire, and I think in part because I started dancing up in this area. That sort of gave me a sense of the history. So I'm right now wondering why the slides aren't advancing. So we'll see what we can do about that. So there we go. I call contras and squares in English, and I'm interested in how they all fit together. So this is nominally about squares, but you'll certainly hear a lot about other forms of related dance. I'm really thankful that CDSS is running this series. I did a one session square dance presentation this summer, and some people said that was good, but it wasn't long enough. You cut the videos too short, so we'll have a little bit more time for that tonight. Before we go any further, I want to thank the Upper Valley Music Center here in Lebanon. They're letting me use their building to stream from which to stream. If we were doing this from our house, Sheila and I live at the end of a dead end road, and there is no information super highway where we live. There is an information rutted road. So thank you, Music Center, for making it possible. So when we talk about square dance, what that means depends a lot on the time and place. And I want to give you an idea of where we're going in this series. Tonight is really the historical background. We'll be looking at England and France and the creation of the cotillon, the cotillion, the dances coming to America, the cotillion to the quadrille. We'll be looking some at early African American influences on the dance. And we'll be finishing up around the turn of the century, early 20th century. Next week, we'll be looking at regional variations, particularly the Northeast and the South. And the final week, we'll be looking at Western dancing, both traditional Western, so-called modern Western square dance, and then something about the revivals. Before we go any farther, I should say a few words about words. One is that I think of squares as a subset of country dance, which is a broad category. And the basic idea of country dance is that dancers are joining the dance as part of a couple and interacting as a couple with other couples. This is distinct from couple dances, such as the waltz and other so-called round dances. If we have modern square dancers out there, they're familiar with the concept of round dances. It's also different from individuals just dancing like line dancing, or individuals Balkan dancing, joining a very large ring of people. So couples interacting with other couples, and we see that in English and in contras and in squares. And in a few other forms. A few disclaimers or a few sort of preliminary remarks. One is you can't look at any dance form without looking at the social context in which it appears. Dance doesn't exist in a vacuum. So from time to time, we'll be looking at why these dances are done the way they are, where they are, and when they are. Second thing to remind you is that this is sort of a linear presentation. I started and I'm running through, but square dance, that concept exists across time and space. So there's going to be some jumping around, and I'll do my best to navigate you through and let you know when I'm going off on a tangent. Square dance is a complicated area of study, which may be why there have been so few attempts made to write a history of square dancing. And I'm continuing to learn about this. I'm not an academically trained square dance historian. It's just been an interest of mine, and I enjoy learning about it. And I'll say some things tonight that were I giving this presentation a year ago, I wouldn't have said, because I'm learning about it all the time. And I'm sure in the questions and comments, I'll learn more and probably have some of my statements brutally challenged by people who know better. And that's how I learn. But that said, I'm really eager to share what I do know and to give a broad overview to show how many different strands come together to create what we think of now as square dancing. And so I hope you come away with a better idea of how these pieces fit together. Joanna mentioned the Square Dance History Project, which I started about 10 or 12 years ago. And one of the guiding ideas was that it's hard to know what squares are if you read about them or if you listen to audio clips. That really the best way is to see them. So to the extent possible, I'm going to be showing a lot of videos. Unfortunately, the video footage from the 1700s and 1800s is a little rough. So in those cases, we'll be using reenactors. But the gold standard for this project has always been to use recordings of real people in actual social settings whenever possible. So that's what we'll be doing. The Square Dance Project got its start with financial support for the webmaster and some other things from CDSS, from the Lloyd Shaw Foundation, those two organizations representing the traditional side of the activity, and then from Collar Lab and Arts Dance, both of which represent more the modern square dance side. And without them, the Square Dance History Project would not exist. It's free. There's nearly 2,000 items online. It's a wonderful rabbit hole for people who are interested in this. So let's look ahead. Squares today and along the way are this complex mix of interrelated forms coming from different cultures. And so we're going to start with English country dance. This is the cover of the English dancing master John Playford's collection of dances, first edition, 1651, the first good collection of instructions for how to do English country dances. There are just over 100 dances in that. About a third of them are longways dances, men on one side, women on the other, similar to contra dances, classic contras. But that leaves two-thirds of the rest of the dances. So what are those dances? There are two couple dances, three couple, four couples in a line, four couples in a square. All these different formations exist in 1651. So here's a short clip of Upon a Summer's Day. This is a three-couple set dance, people in longway sets, gents on one side, ladies on the other. This is the first dance in the first edition of Playford's Dancing Master. Thank you. So what we saw was the first figure up a double and back, forward and back, repeated, and then the chorus, the lines going forward and the first couple moving down. And because there are three couples in the line and the way this dance is structured, the music is the A part, A, and then B, 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 a somewhat unusual figure. And it follows a classic formation that here in the States we refer to as USA dances, up a double, siding. We just saw a little bit of siding and arming, followed by a chorus. And we'll see that later on as we look more into squares. At this point, I need to say something about the dance Hunston House, because many people who look at this casually say, oh, Hunston House has a grand square in it, so that must be the basis of all square dancing. Let's just get it out of the way. Here's the grand square. But this did not lead to square dancing. There is no evidence whatsoever that Hunston House went to France and influenced the French, or that it came to America in the early years. Those of you with science backgrounds know that correlation does not equal causation. And just because this dance has similar figures, similarity in dance figures, does not imply causation. So I just want to get that out of the way, okay? Let's move on. So why am I starting with English country dance? Well, squares didn't just spontaneously erupt, you know, Athena coming from the brow of Zeus. It's a long process to get to where we are today. We've got the final edition of Playford, 1728, about 75 years after the first edition. The number of dances has dramatically increased from just over 100 to more than 900, and all of them except 14 are in longways formations. The longways dances are the ones that come to America with early English colonists, not the very first. They were too busy surviving to worry about dancing, but shortly thereafter. And so we see in Boston, there are dancing schools by the late 17th century. The Puritans, contrary to popular belief, were not uniformly opposed to dancing. In fact, there were ordination balls held for Puritan ministers, and people interested in looking and learning more about that topic. There's a book by Percy Scholes, S-C-H-O-L-E-S, called The Puritans and Music in England and New England, and I commend that to your attention. We have English dances, long ways, coming to the US. Early on, who's dancing? Who are the people who are dancing? Well, early on, it's a very small group. It's nobility, people with the wealth and the time to have private dancing tutors, dancing in court settings, in castles. Later on, we start to see a wider circle of people, upper class and those striving to be upwardly mobile, as dancing moves out of the court and into public ballrooms and other spaces for dancing. The people who are dancing change and the dances change. Between over that century, 1700 to 1800, the dances simplify. A vast number of dances are published, and we are looking at a complex series of relationships in the dance world among England, France, and America. I mentioned that there were dances being published frequently. Typically, it will say something like, 12 new country dances for the year. This is 1799, 24 country dances for the year, 1748, and so on. When the books say new dances for the year, what that typically means is new tunes. That a dance at the time, the word dance usually refers to the tune. And what the publishers would do is they would take a new tune and they would attach a series of figures to it. So some of the same figures can be used again and again and again, sort of generic figures set to different tunes. But there is this notion of something new, and we're going to find that throughout our 3 weeks of talks. There's always this passion for the latest, the newest. In this case, it's new tunes. I mentioned France, and in the late 1600s, English country dances jump the channel. They appear in the court of Louis XIV. All of these dances are longways dances. Mr. Isaac was teaching at the French court in 1684. André Lorrain was sent by Louis XIV on a mission to England, and part of his job was to collect dances and bring them back. So he did. He gathered a series of dances that were being done in England and submitted gave two manuscripts to the king, where he included detailed diagrams which of footwork and how the dance should be done, which the English dance books were notably lacking. But here's the music, and we'll listen to just a little bit of Christchurch Bells. So how did these English dances fit into the French court? Well, evenings started with the performance of couple dances, such as the minuet. And this was, to put it mildly, a high-stress situation. Now, the minuet involves more than just walking around. First of all, you have to learn the basic minuet steps. It's this one down, three, four, five down, which propels you into the opening step. So here's a little of the steps. So you have your steps, and then you have the geography. You're following a carefully prescribed pattern on the floor, in your head on the floor, moving around. So here's an example, dancers moving to an excerpt from Handel's Water Music. So there's a lot there to keep track of, and the dancing masters are right there ready to sell you a book, showing you so that you can study the patterns and learn what to do. There's the introduction, the S reversed or common form, the presentation of the right arm, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So there's all these different figures that you do, and then you have to do it with grace. And one more example of just beautiful, beautiful dancing. some 250 years after this dance was notated, when Caller Lab, the Association of Modern Western Square Dance Callers, was founded, part of their mission, their publicly stated mission, was to bring the dance back into square dance. And I don't know that they were thinking of this much dance, but it does remind us a little of what grace on the dance floor can look like. So we have the steps, we have the figures, we have doing it well, and then there's the social context. Now, I mentioned that the body rises and falls with the steps of the minuet. It's not just your body that rises and falls, it's your standing in court, and there's considerable social pressure. Because everyone is watching you. This is not a group of people all dancing together. It's you and your partner dancing while the rest of the court watches. Now, this particular example is not the minuet, and the dancing is nowhere near as good as what we've just witnessed, but it does give you a sense of the social milieu in which you're dancing. If you do well, if your dancing is good, because everyone watching knows how it's supposed to be. They know the minuet. They could be out there themselves. So if you do well, your standing at court goes up or remains at an elevated level. And if you blow it, if your dancing is clumsy, your status goes way down.
David, I'm sorry to interrupt. Would you mind moving your cursor from the center of your screen, especially when there's a video? Thank you.
There we go. Thank you. So we have country dances. When do they appear? Well, they're later in the evening after the minuet and other couple dances. These longways dances do not have Louis XIV in them. Can you imagine the king any place other than at the head of the line? And we know that in country dances, couples are moving down the line. So they appear late in the evening after the serious dances are done. They're enjoyed, the younger dancers like them. They're simple, they are low stress. And the dancing masters see an opportunity. Aha, people are interested in this form of dance. What can we do to keep them coming to us to learn a new form of dance? So they create a dance based on a traditional French dance, a two-couple dance, a brawl, and come up with a new form, which is named the cotillon and gets anglicized to the cotillion. Writing in 1706, Fouillet says here, an old dance, it is so fashionable at court that I thought I had to include it in this little collection. And he does, and you can see the clear relationship here. They're forward and back, siding, taking hands, taking both hands, stars, circle left and right, close resemblance to the English dances that they're building on. So here's a little taste of what Le Cotillon from 1706 would have perhaps looked like. So we've moved from just one couple dancing with everyone watching them to two couples interacting. And there's a period of interesting experimentation. Here's another cotillon for two couples, this from 1725. Thank you. mention early 18th century experimentation, dancing masters are trying out all kinds of possibilities. Two couple dances. This next one is for six couples, four men and two women. Six dancers. As we move along in the 1700s, the four-couple formation becomes established, and that becomes the norm. It's known as the cotillon, anglicized to cotillion, also known as the contredanse française. When the French borrowed English dances, they also took the name country dance and Frenchified it, francophoned it into contredanse. They could have said danse de campagne, but instead contredanse. So contredanse française refers to these dances in square formation, and the contredanse anglaise refers to dances in longways formation. So here's another example of this contredanse française, and you'll see a lot of creativity in figures. We have English country dance becoming French contredanse, becoming American contredance, and that's why it's called contredance. So one more example from this group that we've been watching earlier. It's a longer clip, but it illustrates nicely the nature of the cotillon slash cotillion. There are an established number of changes that appear in all the cotillions. A change might be circle to the left, circle to the right, or stars and other changes. And those changes appear in every single cotillion. Each one is followed by a distinct figure that repeats again and again. And by mid-1700s, this is the format that the cotillions have. So I'm going to let this one run a little longer, and you'll see a change, and then you'll see the figure, and what made a given dance different from another one was the figure, and then you'll see a different change, and then the same figure repeating. So this one will run just a little bit longer. First change. Here's the figure. Figure again. You change. Figure. Great thing about the cotillon, the cotillion, is once you've learned the changes, you know that you're going to be doing those dance after dance after dance. So to learn a new dance, what you need to learn is the one distinctive figure that's in that. I'm going to do one more, I think, example just to let you see variation. And one of the things I love about digging around in dance history, this is a dance by Gallini called La Royale. And I discovered a little scandal in dance history. Gallini was an Italian dancing master, and a newspaper in Bath, England reported he was introduced as a dancing master into the Earl of Abingdon's family, where Lady Elizabeth Berry, his lordship's eldest daughter, became enamored of him and married him. And you can imagine the scandal to have nobility marrying a common Italian dancing master. The newspaper reported that he was assaulted and booed off stage in 1789 at the height of anti-Gallini fervor. And this led to people, instead of dancing with him, establishing a dancing assembly in a new location at Almack's, a name that becomes important later on in dancing history. So here's a short piece of a cotillon by Gallini. Already, we're starting to see some figures that look familiar. Earlier, we saw a grand right and left going around the square. The jumping up and feet kicking out figure that appears in a lot of the earlier is the rigadoon, which comes into colonial American dancing as well. And these figures of the cotillion are spelled out. This is a Boston publication, The Treatise on Dancing, right here. The figures of cotillions consist of two parts. The one is termed the change, the other the figure. There are 10 changes, which are the same in all regular cotillions, but every cotillion has a different figure. So on. So you can think of this as sort of change and figure as verse and chorus, with a chorus coming around. When we talk about USA English country dances, up a double, siding and arming, with something else in between that. Except that here, if we think of verse chorus, all songs have the same verses and each song has a unique chorus. One last example, and this one with a tune that some of you will remember. And watch for the first change, the figure, the start of the next change. You're hearing the same tune over and over and over. And imagine that tune being played through all 10 changes and the figure being repeated 10 times. This last one is a nice one to show the interaction of opposite couples, which will become a feature in our later quadrilles, which are coming up. So let's look at some of what's happening in the U.S. at this point. We need to draw a distinction to some extent between urban dancing and rural dancing. And we know a lot more about urban dancing or ballroom dancing. These tend to be wealthier individuals who have time to write in their journals to give us a recording of what they did, who they saw, who they danced with, what the dances were, and so on. Rural dancing, we know much less about. People, farmers, tradespeople out in the boondocks were dancing, to be sure, but they did not leave anywhere near as detailed a record of what they were doing. An important thing happens with the American Revolution when the French are supporting the American cause. And because of that, all things French become more valued. There's always a demand for new dances. And in this case, the new dances are French dances, which are these four dances in four couple square formation, as opposed to the older English longways dances. Because there's a demand for new dances, the dancing masters are there ready to supply dances for people. 1789 comes along and the French Revolution. And this brings more dances and more dancing masters to America. If you are a French dancing master and you see your clientele going one by one to the guillotine, you're savvy enough to know that it's time for you to get out of the country, guilt by association. So more dancing masters come to the U.S. Some settle in the East, bringing their dances with them. Many of them travel farther to the West, which at the time are the Northwest Territories, settlements along the Ohio River, the Mississippi River that had been earlier settled by French fur traders. So they go to such towns as Louisville and Saint-Louis, where they have a French-speaking clientele and people who are eager for the latest, newest, hot new dance, and those are the dances in square formation. We see this changeover from English longways dances to French dances in square formation doesn't always go smoothly. And the Louisiana Purchase in 1803 takes place. And in early 1804, as the Port of New Orleans is changing hands from French to American control, there are bitter fights being waged in public ballrooms over the nature of the dance that will be done. The Creole population of New Orleans, which has been dancing French dances, is not happy to see the intrusion of these longways dances. And there are fist fights, brawls, broken violins, people arrested, the police called. And finally, the New Orleans City Council issues a decree that henceforth and hereafter at public balls in the city of New Orleans, one contredanse anglaise, a longways dance, will be followed by two contredanse francaises, two French dances in square formations. We see the War of 1812 coming along, which increases anti-British sentiment in most parts of the country. New England, though, has stronger ties, both family ties and commercial ties with the old country. And so New England, more than most parts of the young nation, hangs on to its longways dances. And we start to see the development of contradances, dances like Hull's Victory, which is written to celebrate a victory, an American naval victory in the War of 1812. There's a strong Scottish influence in these early contras. Hull's Victory is essentially the same dance as Scottish Reform. We see Petronella, a Scottish dance. Lady of the Lake, which was the contra dance in the state of Maine, is the title of a lengthy and influential poem by Sir Walter Scott, written in 1810 and set in Scotland. So the U.S. is changing. And one of the biggest changes comes about because of the nature of American society at this time, which is that it is a nation that relied heavily on slavery. And those Africans brought to America as slaves and their descendants had a major effect on the later development of square dancing. And I want to take a little time to look at that right now. There are changes in the music, and there are changes because of the role of African-American musicians. And we owe a great deal of appreciation for our understanding of these to a caller, musician, and researcher, Phil Jameson, whose book published in 2015 lays out some of the important background that had been overlooked in many of the histories up until that point. And I'll let Phil speak for himself here.
The combination of the banjo with the African banjo with the European fiddle is really what made the music distinctive. Back as early as 1690, slaves were playing fiddles for white people's dances. Before you had, obviously before you had recorded music, to be a musician was a service position. And if surely white people played fiddles, but slaves realized that if you knew how to play the fiddle, you wouldn't be working in the field, but you would be playing for the dances in the big house. And not just slaves, but free blacks played fiddles too. And you were in a different strata.
So we have numerous examples of testifying to the omnipresent role of black musicians at this time. I love this illustration. We have a left-handed fiddler here. In this one set in upstate New York, it's a barber presenting a song recital and accompanied by a black fiddler. Many years ago, we had a popular movie, 12 Years a Slave, the story of Solomon Northrop. Northrop primarily made his living in other ways, but it was his fiddling that took him to the District of Columbia, where he was captured and subsequently enslaved, his 12 Years a Slave. African Americans weren't just playing for white dancers. They also adopted the dances themselves. So here we see a social gathering of enslaved servants of wealthy Southern plantation owners at White Sulphur Springs, the popular resort at the time. This illustration from pre-Civil War in Virginia, we see a man on the side playing the bones, and he has his mouth open. It's possible that he is calling out the dances. Some scholars believe that the first callers in America were African-American. Others dispute that, pointing that there were already in England and in the continent, in France, numerous examples of calling that have been documented. The key thing here in my mind is that blacks in America were part of this new role of someone calling and certainly played a major role in the music of early America. Again, this is not just a Southern phenomenon. You can tell from the title here, Rustic Dance After a Sleigh Ride, that we are not in the Deep South. And I want to look at just two examples from later in the 1800s of black musicians. This one from Greenfield, Massachusetts, a venue that's well known to contra dancers in the East. John Putnam was a very successful caller and orchestra leader and musician. His orchestra consisted of first and second violins, clarinet, cornet, trombone, and bass. And in the 1800s, dances would begin at 8 in the evening and last until 3 or 4 in the morning, with programs including some, 30 dances or so. That might include quadrilles, contra dances, polkas, waltzes. Dances could be 30 miles away, and the orchestra was traveling to these far-flung locations by horse-drawn wagon. So that's the Pioneer Valley of Massachusetts, Alva Belcher operated a grocery store in upstate New York. He had a band which included white musicians. They played from the Catskills to central New York. He was calling dances up until a year before his death. And a newspaper account at the time reported, Belcher's band was an attraction that was sure to draw a crowd. In this comment here, he organized the famous Belcher Band and probably supplied the music to more entertainments and parties than any other person in this vicinity. So Black musicians and callers are very much a part of what's happening in country dancing at this point in America. At this point, I want to stop sharing my screen and let's take a break. People who need to go up to attend to anything else can leave, and we'll take some questions and listen to comments that people have to make. So, Joanna, do you want to call on people? And
yeah, we do have one question. I think you referred to it a little bit just now, but if you want to reiterate, a question was asked, were the early dances memorized or were they called, or when did calling dances actually start?
We'll get into that when we return. The short answer is that calling seems to start at around the time the quadrille takes over from the cotillion. With the cotillion, you could learn that one figure. If you were a good dancer, you already knew all the changes. But in the quadrille, it's a more complicated form. So calling seems to be contemporaneous with the emergence of the quadrille, both on the continent and in the States. And we'll look at that a little bit coming up.
Great, thank you. And here's a request. If you have a link for the book on Puritan dancing, if that can be put in the chat. And David, if you want to find that link, I'm happy to include that in a follow-up email for people.
That would be easier. Great. But yes, I'm happy to do that. The author is Percy Scholes, S-C-H-O-L-E-S. And the title is something about Puritan dancing in England and New England. But with the author's name, I think you'll be able to find it pretty easily.
Great, and I'll find that for sure. And I'll put a link in the follow-up email to everybody. Okay. So everybody has it.
There's a hand up here.
Only questions, yeah. Elaine, you have a hand up. And if you have a question, you can type it in the chat and I'd be happy to ask it for you.
Elaine, we're looking at you. We could ask her to unmute. No, maybe not. Maybe she hit something by mistake or was just bringing food to Craig. Anything else right now? All right. So let's continue. So to recap, we have English country dances are at, by this point, say, 1800 or so. English dances are almost entirely longways. They are really simple, so much so that anyone can learn them at a public dance. The highest ranking individuals, those who gave the ball, the woman of the highest status would decide on some figures, would confer with the orchestra leader, and they would start dancing. And as they danced with their neighboring couple, others in line would be watching, learning the dance. They move on to the next, and those of lower social standing, perhaps down near the end of the line, would be watching hard to see how the dance went. But people were able to pick up the dances on the fly. So the longways dances are simple. The cotillions by now are seen as boring, and they're also long, as are the country dances, because the first couple would work its way down and come back. So we have boring dances in square formation. We have longways dances that are so simple. What is there for the dancing masters to do? Well, one obvious thing is to create a new dance form.
And eventually, the people got tired of doing the changes. So he took a whole bunch of cotillions and put them together, called it a quadrille. Okay. Left out those stupid changes. Everybody can do those, you know. But when you do five cotillions in a row to different music, all in one dance, you got to be good. You got to have gone to dancing school. It's a commodity. Yeah. So dance is a commodity. You have to think of it first as a commodity. And the dancing masters are in charge of that commodity. And they only respond, they want to see where the money is. And the first thing if they see that things are getting bad and people are, the only country dances around are so easy that people don't need them, they're going to think of something new. And so that's when a new fad comes in. To keep themselves employed.
So the change from the cotillion to the quadrille changes the music. Instead of just one tune all the way through, we now have dances with five figures or six figures, each with its own music and each with its own set of movements that you need to learn. And as we move into the 1800s, quadrilles are on the rise. Remember Galini, our friend Galini, who caused such a scandal by marrying above his stature, his status, and Almax becoming the new in location. Well, this is an illustration of the first time a quadrille was danced at Almax in 1815. It was such a popular venue that attendance at the balls there was limited. I love this. You applied through the lady patronesses, who were referred to as a cabal of noble ladies who would approve or reject your request. This illustration shows four of the nobility dancing at Almax: the Marquis of Worcester, Lady Jersey. This fellow, I'd love to know more about him. His name is Clanronald MacDonald, and this is Lady Worcester, and they're in this four in line wave formation. And we'll see some other examples of that. So quadrilles are on the rise. After the Napoleonic Wars end, British soldiers return bringing news of what's going on the continent. And French items are fashionable again. And you can visit France to find out what's going on. French cuisine, French costumes, French clothing become fashionable. And French dancing, and the new French dancing becomes the quadrille, this more complex form. Quadrilles appear in high society in London first in 1815. And here's an example of that dance being done for us. La poule. Here's that wave. Side couples, and so on and so on. This Edward Payne, P-A-Y-N-E, had a set of quadrilles in 1815. This is James Payne. His first set is 1816. He was an orchestra leader and proud to announce Payne of Almax. It was like brand name recognition. He published 17 sets of quadrilles between 1816 and 1821. So this is a popular dance form. He's putting out a lot of new music, and people are eager to try it. Here in this caricature, we see that same four-in-line wave figure. Dancers practicing the quadrilles were more complicated than the English dances and then the cotillions. One interesting thing here is in the background, you see a fiddler, and there's a little word balloon coming out of his mouth, which says, La Poule. Is he calling? Is he announcing the figure? We see similar little word balloons from time to time in other caricatures. The first set was followed in 1817 by the Lancers, which was popular at the time, faded for a bit, but then came back again in the middle of the 19th century. And the dancers in this particular excerpt are in more mid-century costuming. Five figures, each with its own tune, and typical quadrille figures have opposite couples interacting with each other. And so on and so on and so on. There are numerous examples of these caricatures. These are from England. And the fact that there were so many of them and that there was a ready market illustrates that people were familiar enough with the dance form so that they would get the joke. You don't start going to such length to create popular works of art if people can't relate to what's being shown. So, here we see the elegancies of quadrille dancing. And in this example, excuse me, practicing for fear of accidents, for fear of sneezing. The dancing masters have made your job a little more complicated. Payne's first set, I'm indebted to Richard Powers for this, requires that you need to know what to do in terms of figures, hands, and feet for 208 measures of music. So obviously there's a need for a dancing master. We see in England, France, and the US numerous mentions of calling, starting with the introduction of the quadrille. Mr. Chivers in London, 1829, writes, "It being the general custom of calling the figures while dancing, all persons should make themselves acquainted with the French technical terms." And in the 1830s and beyond, as quadrilles spread to the US, we see frequent references to calling in dance manuals. Another thing about quadrilles is that, unlike the longways dances, where you have to interact with many dancers along a long line, in a set, you can form your own small group of four couples and dance with your friends, with the smart set, with whomever you want to. And so the quadrilles become fashionable and they take over the ballroom. I'll play some music, but take a look here at the number of quadrilles on these mid-19th century ballroom programs. Ditto, ditto. Lots and lots of quadrilles. And sure enough, in popular culture, we start to see quadrilles turning up. This is from Alice's Adventures in Wonderland. And again, Lewis Carroll isn't going to put in the lobster quadrille unless his readers know what a quadrille is and can relate to that. So when they're making funny things here, you throw the lobsters as far out to sea as you can, swim after them. This is feels like Bugs Bunny doing a hillbilly hare. Dance appears in popular forms when it's enough of a presence to be recognized by readers and viewers. So another example of a 19th century quadrille, this with music by the March King himself, John Philip Sousa. This is filmed at the Great Hall in the Library of Congress in DC. One final example of quadrilles. This, a group of Black dancers in 1914, filmed in San Francisco. Classic quadrille figures. It's silent, so I'll take the liberty of calling out the figures, just drawing them to your attention. Very common quadrille figures with opposite couples interacting. So here we see couples right and left through, and right and left back, ladies chain, and chain back. Look to your corner, swing your corner, go back and grand right and left, work your way around the square. Little different styling than the early ones we saw of grand right and left. Swing your partner, and there you are. So let's just take another break. Any questions at this point? And then we have two other sections and we'll be done by 20-25 minutes.
So David, a number of questions have come in since our last break.
Yeah.
So here's one. Were the changes, in the cotillion dancing,
yep,
the same in different geographic locations?
I don't know. I don't know. My understanding from what I've read is that a cotillion was a cotillion, and I don't know whether a French cotillon would have a significantly different. It's a great question, and if someone knows the answer in the audience who can chime in, that's great. I'll try to find out for the next time I give one of these talks. Great. Thank you.
Thank you. Here's another good question. So did fashion styles from France have an effect on any of the dance figures? So big hoop skirts, wigs, et cetera, and so forth.
It must have, that different fashion styles affect the way you dance. The classic example, this is not related here, but I remember a presentation in Victoria, British Columbia, where a group of women demonstrated clothing styles over the years and learning that in mid-1600s, Playford era, women were dancing with boards, basically, against their stomach to hold them their posture erect, and that the dresses they were wearing were cut so that they could not extend their arms all the way down. It forced them to keep their arms up. And I don't know enough about fashion, but it has to have affected the way people danced. We'll see. We'll see an example in a little bit of dancing with people in big hoop skirts where they're keeping a lot of distance between them. It has to have affected choreography.
Great, thank you. One comment, not a question, is that it's interesting that the story of this folk dance form is centered so much in the economic concerns of publishers and dancing masters and not in the folk so much.
Well, we're focusing here mostly on the urban setting, the ballroom setting, the higher classes. As I mentioned at the start, we know much less, and I certainly know much less about what was going on in rural society, but dancing masters did travel. John Griffiths in Rhode Island in Providence, who published in 1788, the first book of dances in America, traveled from there as far north as Keene, New Hampshire and Walpole, New Hampshire. That's quite a ways to go in the late 1700s. And he was a traveling dancing master, going from town to town, holding schools and teaching dancing. So the dancing masters are in it to make a living. And they have a great effect. If they come into town and teach the tango, people will learn the tango. And if they're teaching the quadrilles, and people in the countryside, even as they hang on to some of the older dance forms, are eager to know what's going on, what's the latest new thing. So the dancing masters are the ones who bring that information with them. People want to stay up to date.
So here are a couple of quick questions, and then I think we can save any others for the end. Do you know what it's called when four couples work simultaneously in a dance? That might that be called canon style?
I don't, sorry.
Okay. And then when did some of these fancy steps, like the rigadoon, when did they disappear from the dance form?
I remember being at Pine Woods, taking a class on early American dance with Jim Morrison. And we did a lot of rigadooning. Some people were extremely graceful with it. I was not at all. They were certainly there at the time of the American Revolution. And my sense is that they die out sometime after that in the States and probably in England. They don't feature in the longways English dances. They're not seen much as we move into the 1800s. A dance like Hull's Victory from 1812 doesn't have that. It seems in the States, it seems to be replaced, and this is speculation, by figures such as balance, which gives you that percussive movement. And so I don't know. I think there's probably a fading off as customs change and new things come along.
Great, thank you. So why don't we hold anything else for the end? So if you have any questions, just keep typing them in and great, I will pose them to David at the end.
Okay, so we're gonna take a slight detour into the realm of couple dances. Dance styles come and go. We already saw how English longways dances and contras, for that matter, and the early cotillion were displaced by the quadrilles. Those ball programs that we looked at a couple minutes ago was dominated by quadrilles, and quadrilles themselves were pushed aside by the rise of couple dance. So waltzing initially is seen as scandalous, déclassé. And then waltz is accompanied by another form of dance. And at this point, I'd like everyone to just stand up, stretch your arms. Come on, stand up. I can see a few. Loosen your arms. And if you were alive anytime after 1995, this is for you. I'm going to play a little bit of music, and I'd like you to do what the music tells you to do. Ready? Here we go. Why am I putting the Macarena in? Well, remember when that came along, you had never heard of it, and then it was everywhere. I was an elementary school teacher, and at school assemblies with 200 kids, the Macarena would get played, and everyone, faculty, students alike, were dancing. That's what the polka was. It was a bona fide dance craze. It swept through the Western dance world from Prague to Vienna to Paris to London and to the US. And I'll give you some time to read this this account. And as Richard Powers points out, the polka made it acceptable to hold someone in your arms in a closed position. And that revolutionized the nature of waltzing that took place. The change, the polka swept through America, and dancing masters, eager to hang on to another source, adapted it to the quadrille, taking an older form and suddenly putting a polka to it to have something new to teach. And this figure that you'll see here looks very much like our earlier dance of Marlbrook, the bear went over the mountain, yeah, da, 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 but different music set to polka. The question earlier about how fashion affected dancing, you notice there that the dancers are considerably apart from each other and able to do the dance. So these couple dances, the waltz, the polka, the schottische, take over on ballroom floors, less so, I'm told, in the South, because there weren't as many public ballrooms and more dancing was in smaller settings, but throughout the North, along the Northern and Mid-Atlantic seaboard, major changes in what's happening. So by the time we get late in the 19th century, couple dances dominate the dance floor. I love Alan Winston's phrase here. Country dancing had retreated to, well, the country, where people were hanging on to the old ways. And in the 20th century, we see a series of revivals. And this will be the last section of the talk tonight. I want to look at just a couple things going on. In the late 19th century and early 20th century, there's a vast wave of immigration. I've heard it referred to as the third wave. Some 25 million people coming into the US. Unlike early settlers from England, from the British Isles, from Germany, these immigrants are from Southern and Eastern Europe, Italians, Greeks, Hungarians, Poles, people speaking Slavic languages, 3 to 4 million Jews. These people coming to America, mostly settling in urban areas, and there were many different responses all taking place at roughly the same time of ways of coping with the immigration and supporting immigrants, helping them adjust to American society. We see Jane Addams starting Hull House out in Chicago. In Kentucky, Eastern Kentucky is the start of the settlement schools. Many of these endeavors founded, supported by women, college graduates from schools such as Smith and Wellesley. And in New York City, we see a rise of efforts to work with the immigrants. And I'm going to focus on two individuals who may not be as well known. The first is Luther Halsey Gulick. He is a key individual here. And some of these people play an important role in promoting dance in school and community settings. And their work eventually leads to that phenomenon that so many of us are familiar with, which is square dancing in PE classes throughout the US. Gulick was a teacher at the YMCA College, Springfield College in Massachusetts. He gave his students, his PE students, once an assignment to design a game that athletes could play over the winter. And one of his students, James Naismith, invented basketball. Gulick created the logo for the Y. He was the head of physical education for New York City. He starts the Public School Athletic League, which is specifically aimed at helping boys in athletics. And he asks prominent women to form a girls' branch. This is 1903. And he's part of this movement called Muscular Christianity. And I'll say a little more about that in a bit. He's president of the newly formed Playground Association of America. This is part of the whole milieu at the time, these social movements, creating settlement houses, creating playgrounds. One author writes, recreation not only benefited the individual, but also transformed a nation of alien immigrants or downtrodden, unhealthy factory workers into cohesive, healthy population of citizens working for common good or ready to defend their country. The notion is that we're taking into America these give me your tired, your poor, your huddled masses yearning to breathe free, that we bring them together in settlement houses. We create playgrounds where their children can play safely. We bring them together to share their own culture that they can take pride in so that they can stand tall and strong. And in this way, learn to shoulder the burdens of being citizens of a democratic nation. The Playground Association later becomes merges with other groups to promote recreation in all forms. Gulick is hired by the Russell Sage Foundation, chairs their committee on folk dancing. Russell Sage is the same foundation that sponsors John C. Campbell on his research in Appalachia as he travels around to learn how to improve farming techniques. And his wife, Olive Dame Campbell, is traveling around learning about culture, collecting songs, which she later shares with Cecil Sharp. In 1910, Gulick publishes The Healthful Art of Dancing, where he argues that it's not just movement, but that dancing brings something more than just physical movement. It brings grace and coordination in a way that athletics perhaps does not promote. He forms the Campfire Girls with his wife. This is a busy man, and he actively promotes the work being done by Elizabeth Birchenau. Now, Birchenau herself is an interesting person. She is a graduate of Earlham College, who then goes on to study at the Sargent School of Physical Education at the University of Boston at BU. And in 1903, Birchenau becomes an instructor of physical education at Teachers College, Columbia, where she introduces folk dance into the curriculum. She travels to the settlement houses, collects dances from immigrants. Even as a child, her family had brought visitors into their home from other cultures, and she was interested in folk dancing. A few years later, she left Columbia at Gulick's urging to become the executive secretary of the girls' branch of the Public School Athletic League. And in that role, she promoted folk dancing and established principles for teaching folk dancing, including no solo dances, just social dancing, not exhibition dancing. People were learning to dance, the girls were learning to dance, not so much to put on shows, but for the pleasure of dancing. And within a few years, by 1907, she had some 250 teachers teaching folk dance in schools throughout New York. She includes English country dancing, as well as and maypole dancing, and international folk. Now, she was familiar with English country dance. She had been to England in 1908 and 1910, collecting Morris dances in Bampton and elsewhere. And when the American branch of the English Folk Dance Society, the predecessor of CDSS, was formed in 1915, Helen Starrow was the first secretary and Elizabeth Birchenell was the treasurer of the American branch. Within a year, disagreements with Cecil Sharp led her to form a separate American Folk Dance Society. And this is reminiscent of the struggles where Sharp did not like to be challenged by women. We saw this earlier with him and Mary Neal. That's another talk. And Birchenell went on to actively promote folk dance until her death in 1959. We're going to see Sharp in our next session, and Birchenell plays a vital role in square dance, which we'll get to in our third session. So Birchenell is collecting dances in Europe, folk dances from old homelands, folk dances of Denmark. She travels around, collects dances, published more than a dozen books in all, and starts teaching them and teaching teachers how to teach the dance. The Public School Athletic League is focused on boys, but the girls' branch adds activities for girls. And there are playgrounds that can be used, but they're also looking for ways to use any available space, including dancing on rooftops. Here they're dancing on the grass, people are watching. And she organized folk dance festivals. At one point, there were 10,000 girls dancing in Central Park. Birchenell was not just interested in international folk. She was also interested in American dances. And her American Country Dances book was published in 1918 based on field research. This is not just a collection of dances created by a dancing master, but actual observation of dances being done at community dances. Here's a detailed description of the buzz step. And also in 1918, she releases a series of recordings. Here's one of Money Musk. She continues recording. This one is a selection of a quadrille recording from 1927, sort of resurrecting some earlier dance forms and sharing them. She remains involved in folk dance activities, as I mentioned, through the 1950s. This is a paper she delivered in 1951, where she starts looking at American folk dances by tracing migration patterns, patterns of settlement, the ethnic roots of settlers in different regions. And we'll see more of that in our next couple of presentations. She identifies four outstanding regional types. First are the New England country dances, the Appalachian mountain dances. These are the big sets. The Midwest and Mid-South play party games. These are dances in everything but name. People are moving, but they're singing and clapping. No fiddles allowed. The fiddle is the devil's instrument, and play parties are formed as a reaction to the church's not holding dancing as a favorable thing to do. And finally, what she calls the countrywide square dance. And she says, it has no single identifiable foreign nationality background. It appears to be an American phenomenon produced by the mixture of people forming the body of our settlers. And it's this mixture of people coming from different places, bringing different traits with them, different musics, different forms of dance that combine in interesting fashions to form what becomes the different forms of American folk dance. So a brief summary of where we've been and a look at where we're going. We had the English country dance moving to France, the French dancing masters introducing the cotillon, that in turn turning into the quadrille, a few words about the key role played by Black musicians and callers, the rise and fall of all forms of dance, one form displaced by another, and the push for couple dances, and finally, the first of several revivals of interest. And in fact, next week we'll be starting with another person who plays a key role in that. So here's a brief coming attractions. We'll be looking at Henry Ford. We'll be looking at Grace Ryan, a key individual also from Michigan. We'll be looking at dances from the Maritimes. That's an example from Cape Breton. We'll be looking at some other features of Northern squares, singing squares in particular.
All four couples separate around the outside ring. All the way around the ring and neither coming back.
And dances from elsewhere. And continuing.
First little couple, out to the right. Join that couple and get them tight.
We'll continue looking at African-American involvement in square dancing. This is an early movie, 1930s, made by Elizabeth Burchinol.
Third couple, lead to the right and round that couple. Take a little peek. Back to the center and swing, swing. Now around you go and you beat one more.
Dances from Appalachia and from the South. And as the dancing starts to move west, we'll be spending a little bit of time looking at dances coming from the Ozarks. Almost all the videos that I've shown here can be found in their longer form at the Square Dance History Project, squaredancehistory.org. Thank you for coming. I'd love to get questions and emails. Some people try contacting me through Facebook. That does not work. There's my address. You can look in the CDSS directory, davidmillstone7@gmail.com. And we'll pause. I'm going to shut off my sharing and take some questions and we can talk some. And thank you for being here. It's fun to talk about this with people who are interested. Next week will be Northeastern and Southern squares. Stop sharing. And how do I get rid of this? Let's see. Da, da, da.
So thank you, David. While David is doing some things with his screen, I'll just reiterate that we will have a presentation at the same time next week, which is the 17th of February. And again, it will begin at 8 p.m. Eastern. If you've saved the Zoom link, it is the same, but I will send a reminder email the Friday beforehand, just so you can have that Zoom link fresh in your email. And David, a few more questions have come in, so I'll ask them of you. Which came first, polka music or the polka step?
I have no idea. They have to have originated I don't know. I leave it to some. If you know the answer, please let me know. I do know that polka dots became the fashion at the time of the polka. So we can thank the 1840s for polka dots, you know, on American dance floors in the 1950s, along with poodle skirts.
It's another fashion tie-in, I think.
Right.
And one other question that has come in, which is about the buzz step and contradancing. When did that come into favor in contradancing, and did that kind of footwork appear in any European folk dances?
Again, I don't know. I know that the swing, that the extended swing, we'll look at this a little next week, comes into contradancing through French Canada, through Quebec, where long swings are a feature of Quebecois dancing. And the music from Canada certainly affects New England dancing. And the main effect that Quebecois dances have on New England dances is the long swing. Most places in the country, a swing is once around or twice. This is true in modern square dancing too. Once around, I think, is the norm. But in New England, anything less than an 8-count swing is shockingly short, and it's usually 12 or 16 counts. In Quebec, it can be as long as 32 counts of swing. But I don't know about buzz step swinging in.
I can add something there.
Thanks, Richard.
Radenstock in England, and also especially Edward Scott, described very clearly the bus step swing in the 1870s and 1880s in England. Doesn't mean it started there, but we do know it was done there, especially in the evolving Lancers becoming a rowdy dance, the Kitchen Lancers, which was characterized by the buzz step swing, which he first disapproved of and soon taught.
Right, because that's where the money was.
Yep.
Thank you.
Great. And one last question, which is about the relationship of the quadrille dance to that dance form that is still done in St. Croix today, also called the quadrille.
Yes. And the Caribbean quadrille certainly comes from Europe. It's what I loved when I got to do the quadrille 2 years ago on St. Croix was having the floor master calling out tournée, and so hearing French calls interspersed with calls in English, and the tournée was just part of what was done. On the Square Dance History Project, we do not devote much time to Caribbean quadrilles, and for that matter, to quadrilles elsewhere in Europe. I needed to draw some limits. And so there's not as much on that site. And unfortunately, next week, there won't be as much on dance forms from, say, the upper Midwest, the Métis square dance, which is a blend of native and French dancing, the Red River Jig in northern Minnesota and the Prairie provinces. Again, I don't know as much about it. There is a wonderful film about it. There's probably a book out there about Caribbean quadrilles that I've not yet read. And I encourage people to learn about it and to direct me to good videos, and we can include them.
So this is a good moment to just talk about another follow-up thing. There was a request to see another screen of the slides, but this presentation has been recorded, and I will be sharing a recording with all of you. So if there are any videos you wanted to watch again, you will have an opportunity to do that. So look for that video early next week.
And the Square Dance History Project, squaredancehistory.org, does have a pretty good search function. A warning, it can take you down a rabbit hole, but if you put in a word or two of what you're looking for, chances are you'll find it, and then you'll find more and more. And as I say, there's between 1900 and 2000 items on there, and the list keeps growing, limited only by my time and interest in adding more things to it. So.
Well, thank you, David Millstone, so much for sharing all of your knowledge with us and all of these wonderful videos. And I look forward to seeing all of you and next week's presentation.
Next week will be fun. There'll be more videos, less of people recreating older dances and more of people in social settings dancing. And I'm really excited about some of the footage that we found and are able to share with you. So thank you very much for coming. This has been a treat. I'm going to save the chat so I can see what people have been doing. Don't cut it off yet, Joanna. Save chat. And again, davidmillstone7@gmail.com. If you have additional questions, and especially if you have corrections, I really appreciate that's how I learn to do better next time. Thank you very much.
Thanks, everyone. Good night. Hopefully we'll see you next week.